جزاكم الله خير. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا، والصلاة والسلام على إمام الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Before going to our session, really, this is a very important issue. When a Muslim is oppressed, you have at least to show some sort of sympathy towards him. Any Muslim in any place in the world, there is a sort of relationship between all of us as a Muslimin. And when a Muslim is living with us in this country and he is in jail for 8 years without being charged, this is something cannot be accepted at all, even by the rules. And Islamically, also in Islam, there is no unjust, even with the kuffar. And we don't accept it for ourselves, and we don't accept it for any human being. This brother has been imprisoned for 8 years now. And he is now in his way, the great threat now that he will be deported to United States of America. And if you don't know about the jail in America, this is something really horrible. They can die there, nobody knows, for years. And we have Sheikh Omar Abdulrahman. He has been there now for 18 years in America, in one cell, alone. And he just have a call talk or a phone talk to his family once every month. 15 minutes. He is a blind sheikh over 70 years, scholar in Sharia, and has nothing, he had done nothing yet. And his sentence in America is for life, 250 years. And now they are going to send other Muslim brothers from here. Abu Hamza, the Egyptian Abu Hamza, Adil Abdul Majid, the Saudi Khalid Al Fawaz, as well as Babar Ahmed. And they preparing a plane to take all of them. We have to do our best to stop this. If you are a real Muslim having some iman in your heart, this is your brother. All of these are your brothers. If we can do anything, we have to do it without any laziness, without any hesitation. So the brothers here, when they say write letters, okay, yes, this is a very simple thing. If there is a way for demonstration, yes, we will share. If there is a way to do anything to stop this unjust for our brother Babar and the other brother, we have to do it if we are real Muslimin. Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. Babar is my brother. Babar is my brother. And Adil is my brother. Khalid al-Fawaz is my brother. I am not talking about now the legal issues they have done or not, but sending them to America is killing them, with a thread of harir, silicon. We want our brothers to be even, if there is a trial, a judge, whatever, and they can see their families, and they can stay, although in this horrible condition, in jail, but they are still human beings. They have to be seen by their husband, wives, their kids, their families, and so on and so. So I am urging you, all of you, because Islam is not a theory. We are not just talking and reading books. Islam is practice, is life. Are you living as a Muslim, or you are just interesting your time, just or wasting your time? It is not theory. Be sure. We are not teaching matters just to read or to memorize. Islam is life. How to live? How to live with this iman in your heart and practicing in your life? May Allah free them all, inshallah, and give them the victory we wish. Right, let us come to our listen now, and I'll make a brief, just a reminding of the topic which we mentioned or the issue which we discussed last week. And as I mentioned last week, it will be our journey with the shaitan. We are now having our time with al-shaytan al-rajim. And as we said before, and I have to repeat it, iman is in the heart. And the heart is your castle, fortress. The shaytan is running in your body. And his main goal is to attack this castle and to destroy the iman in it. Khalas? And every one of us has his own shaitan. Allah who created us and who gave me this soul, ruh, and every one of human beings has his soul from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I didn't create myself. Allah said that I created you and all human beings and all creation, and I created shaitan, jinn, iblis, as Allah created malaika, as Allah created things which we don't know. وَيَخْلُقُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Just 50 years ago, they discovered that there is something called bacteria, viruses. Before 100 years, before the microscope, nobody knows anything. And it is a huge world. Those who study science, they know the world of bacteria. Very, very minute microorganisms that can attack you. A very small bacteria that cannot be seen. If it attacks your eye, it can turn you to be a blind man. Very, very few bacteria can destroy your gastrointestinal system. There is viruses. There are other creations which we don't know. Shaitan is a matter of fact. Allah created shaitan even before Adam was created. And every one of us has a qareen with him, shaitan. We said last week that the target of the shaitan is you. What is you? يعني my iman. Because he was cursed and he was ordered to be out of Jannah and he refused to make sujood to Adam, he said that, O Allah, I swear by Allah, the shaitan said that I will destroy Adam and all his descendants. وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرَهُمْ شَكِرِينَ. I will turn them away from being grateful to you, Allah. There is a battle, a struggle, a fight, a conflict in the heart of everyone of us. Many people are very relaxed because they are very friends to their shaitan. The shaitan doesn't need to do any effort. They themselves are more worse than the shaitan. So the shaitan is very happy with those people. He commits zina, he takes haram, he does whatever he wants. He doesn't care about any obligations. He is shaitan of ins. Shayateen al-ins, as we all know in the surah of Surah An-Nas, the great surah for isti'adah, to seek refuge with Allah from the shaitan, is to recite Surah An-Nas. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ. So there are shayateen of nas. Nas يعني human being. But our talking today is with our shaitan, who is with every one of us. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam named him as al-qareen, qareen. And it is mentioned in ayat of the Quran. وَقَالَ قَرِينُهُ رَبَّنَا مَا أَطْغَيْتُ وَلَكِنْ كَانَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ قَالَ لَا تَخْتَصِمُ لَدَيَّ وَقَدْ قَدَّمْتُ إِلَيْكُمْ. يعني in Surah Qaf there is a debate between your قرين and yourself in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is the big talk of the shaitan, Iblis, in the day of judgment before entering to hellfire. And there are many ayat of the Quran, many, many. When we say many, it is many, many, abundant. Ayat talking about this enemy. Allah said, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوٌ. يعني the warning of the shaitan is great in the Holy Quran. The hadith of the Qareen that Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ما من أحد منكم إلا وله قريب. None of you but has a Qareen with him, a shaitan. خلاص. So it is a fact now. Either you are a man or a woman, the shaitan is with you till you die. He will never leave you till your soul depart your body. Okay. The battlefield now is your heart. The goals of the shaitan, I said it last week. Six things. He's doing his best with you. Number one, turning you to be a yalla shiukh Whitechapel or East London. Kafir, mushrik. Number one, he wants you before death to be a kafir or a mushrik. Halas? Number two, mubtadi', innovation. And we said there are bid'ah of kufr. Some bid'ah are kufr 100%. And we may have a time, inshallah, to talk about the bid'ah in Islam. It needs to be discussed. So he wants you to be a mubtadi'. Mubtadi', يعني you are not following the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. You are not following the Quran. You have your own religion. يعني your own thoughts. You don't care about the sunnah. And you think that you are right. And we will go through the bid'ah quickly, inshallah, when we talk about how the penetration of the shaitan. Number three, major sin. Go to zina, drink, alcohol, drugs, take some money, thief. And all the major sins you may imagine. Angry, okay, take a small knife, kill, you are a murderer. يبقى عندك خمرة, زنا, سرقة, قتل, الكبائر, الموبقات. طيب, you are a good man, he couldn't do this with you, no, a kafir. You are not a مبتدع, because you have knowledge, you know what is the sunnah, what is the bid'ah. And you are not going to do major sins. Okay, go to the minor sins. Backbiting, looking, doing bad things. Many, many minor sins. And he pushes you towards it. Do it. Do it. He comes. Because you are a good Muslim. You know his enmity. So he will turn you to lose the priorities. What is better and best for you? No, no, no. Take something less. Okay, you are a very good Muslim. What is he going to do? As we mentioned before, he will try the other people. He will try to put hatred against you and push, inspire other people to harm you. And we said two things that is beyond our hands. Mentioned in Surah Al-Falaq. Two things. I can do nothing regarding it except by abiding to the Quran and asking Allah's help. What are these two things that people can harm me without even feeling or without having any precautions. Hasad. One of them, hasad. Hasad يعني in English?
Envy.
Envy. A man sitting with me, coming to my house, and he has a very wicked soul. خبيث. نفسه خبيثة. Corrupted heart. And he gave you this, they say a blue eye or sharifi, hasad. Hasad is true. It may happen. When he starts, al-hasad needs some effort from the hasid. And the other thing is, what in Surah Al-Falaq? Sih. يبقى في سحر وفي حسد. سحر is mentioned very clear in Surah Al-Baqarah, especially with the Jew. They are the masters of سحر all over the world. السحر. And السحر generally, there are many issues in the سحر. We are not going to go into details, but they have some sort of relation with the shayateen. And to be a sahir, you have to be kafir first. And then they go with the shaitan in harming others. اتبعوا ما تتلو الشياطين على ملك سليمان وما كفر سليمان ولكن الشياطين كفروا يعلمون الناس السحر. فسورة الفلق protect me as a Muslim, as well as Surah An-Nas, and these are the last two surahs in the Holy Quran. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said when it was revealed to him, he was very happy. And he said, this is enough for anyone who seek refuge with Allah from all harm in this dunya. Harm can be from yourself, inside you. This is the shaitan. So you say, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس. Oh Allah, help me for my shaitan and all the other shayateen. He will flee. The shaitan is very weak. Very, very weak. Whenever you remember Allah, he will وسواس خناس. What is خناس? خناس يعني escaping, flee. He is with you, and today we will see how he can play on you as the boy plays with his toys. So if you are a real Muslim with just a simple knowledge, Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said, and we will say it, قل أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. استعد بالله. The man was very angry and disputing together, and he, so Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said to the one of them, the two men who were fighting and quarreling, he said to him, tell your brother that if he says a word, he will calm down. قل أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. I seek refuge with Allah from this shaitan. But the man, and the hadith is in Sahih, the man was very angry and he was fighting and quarreling. And when the Sahabi said to him, say, Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم says to you, قل أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, to calm down. He said, because of his anger, and look how the shaitan controlled him, he replied, no, do you think I am a crazy insane? The shaitan knows the weakness in every one of us. And we are human beings. We have nature. Today, inshallah, we will talk about how the shaitan will enter. The methods employed by the shaitan to misguide man. Really, there is a lot of books, alhamdulillah, and we have a lot of scholars who wrote about these things. And one of the greatest scholars, as I mentioned, Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, Ahmad Ibn Abdul Halim Ibn Taymiyyah, Shaykh al-Islam, who passed the year 728 after Hijra. Remember his name and search for all his works. One of the top of the top. Ahmad ibn Abdul Halim ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah. From Asham, from Syria. He passed 728. He is encyclopedia. He was encyclopedia. Ibn Taymiyyah wrote a book about the diseases of the heart and the whispering of the shaitan. One of his students became a great scholar, Shamsuddin Ibn Qayyim al-Juziyya, Ibn al-Qayyim. He is one of his students who was with him for a long time, and even he was imprisoned with him in Syria. Ibn Taymiyyah passed 728. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim al-Juziyya passed 751. In which year we are now? Hijri. 1433. We are talking about these scholars, they passed 700 years ago. And still their books all over the world. And there are others, of course. Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali. 505. Also one of the great scholars. But his books had some issues of defect regarding weak ahadith, and he became a Sufi for a time. Then, alhamdulillah, he returned back to the Sunni, but he wrote wonderful books regarding the human nature, psychological treatment by Islam, how to deal with the human being, his soul, and other scholars. I'm not going to mention all of them now, but these three are very, very well known. Of course, Imam Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, Abd al-Rahman Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, sahib kitab Jami' al-Ulum wal-Hikam, who also made an explanation for the 40 Nawawi hadith. He added 10 hadith and he made a wonderful book. Imam Abd al-Rahman ibn Rajab al-Hanbali. طيب. So you have Surah Al-Falaq, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ. You have Surah قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. Sayyida Aisha, in the authentic hadith, she said, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to recite these two surahs, as well as with قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, every night before his sleep. يَبْقَى يَبْنِ الْحَلَالِ, يَا مُسْلِمْ, who are following the Prophet, before you sleep, either you are in wudu or not, but try to be in wudu. Much better to sleep in wudu. Recite these three surahs. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. And tell your beloved wife before she sleeps. And teach your kids. And tell your mother. This is our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is a huge protection. A protection from the hasad, these evil souls, which you don't know, as well as the sahar, and now they are spread, unfortunately, in Morocco, in Egypt, in Sudan, in Pakistan, Asia. As-sahir kafir, again. As-sahir kafir. And the had of the sahir is to be killed in Islam. When there is an Islamic state, no sahara. No one can go say, okay, I'm going to the sahir, asking him for so and so. No way. But because we are living in most of the Muslim and Arabic countries which they are not implementing Sharia, you find sahara. And even they have their own shops and places, and you can go easily to them, and you pay them, and they can do the harm for the Muslimin. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa warned us about the sihr. Anybody goes to the sahir, even just to listen to him, 40 days his salah is not accepted. If you believe in him, you are a kafir. you turn to kufr. طيب, now let us see if the shaitan couldn't go on all of this, he will never leave you, and he will try to come to you when you are weak. خلاص. And every one of us may know his weakness, which is hidden. Everyone try to appear in front of the others that he is perfect or he is good or whatever. But the reality that every one of us has his own points of weakness. Of course, desires is part of this. When it goes beyond the limit and you cannot control it, you become very weak. Desires, lusts. And I mean by this the attraction to the other sex. It is a point of weakness. If you cannot control it and manage it and treat it, the shaitan will يعني, make his goal very easy with you by the issues of woman. And because of that, you will find a lot of things regarding the relationship between the man and the woman. From the beginning, we are ordered to make غض البصر, lower your gaze. We are ordered not to be alone with one woman. الخلوة is haram in Islam, if she is a foreigner. We are ordered to speak good things if you are talking to women. Women should dress, cover their body. And if they cover their face, this is much better. To wear the niqab as Ummahat al-Mu'mineen. With the debate of the scholars, is it obligatory or not? Some of the scholars says, yes, she has to cover her face. Others with the opinion, no, she may not cover her face and her hands. But this is not our... But her body should be completely covered, all of them. She shouldn't be attractive outside her house. When she is outside, كنا نخرج تفيلات. تفيلات. تفيلات يعني not attractive at all. يعني as if she is wearing a tent. You want to be attractive at home with your husband. Do whatever you want. But outside there are men. And there are weak men. And every man has two eyes. And there are many precautions had done so that the shaitan cannot attack you from this issue, which is innocent. We are ordered to get married as soon as we can. يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابِ مَنْ إِسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاءَ فَلْيَتَزَوَّجْ. What are you waiting for? Either you are a man or a woman. And again, this is the Western culture. I'm not going to get married till I finish my school, okay, my uni, okay, then I'm going to work, okay, then I have to get saving, okay, how old are you? 30. And unfortunately, or not unfortunately, look to how they brainwashed the Muslim woman. Yeah. Now the Muslim women are doing the same thing. School, uni, then she wants to work, she wants to give money, she's very independent, خلاص, I don't want to, I'm not in need of anything. And type 30, 35, you are خلاص, bye-bye, you are coming to. Marriage should be from puberty, 16, 17, 19, 20, why to wait? And there are burning things in the body. These hormones as a male or a female. So Islam is very, very clear and direct. Whoever can afford marriage, marry. Go to marriage. خلاص, alhamdulillah, you will calm down. You will be safe. The shaitan cannot play this game with you. But if you are single, what can we say? فعليك بالصوم. As the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you are a single man, غلبان, مسكين. ومن لم يستطع who cannot offer for marriage فعليه بالصوم فإنه له وجاء. وجاء يعني protection. It is a shield. But are you going to fast يعني for the whole year? طيب, let us go with our book now. What are the ways of the shaitan entering and attacking you? Look here to the scholar said. The shaitan's enters. We have ignorance, anger, loving the dunya, lasting hope, being greed, kibr, arrogance, loving of praising and riya, and al-ujb, vanity, anxiety and restlessness, following your hawa and desire, having low opinion of others, despising the Muslims, underestimating the value of sins, feeling secure about Allah's devising, and despairing the mercy of Allah. These are some of the points which we will discuss briefly to know that how the shaitan can control you, how the shaitan can push you towards his targets. Yani to give you a quick example, I have one of my relatives, this was 20 years ago, he got cancer, and his cancer was yani very hard, really. It appeared in the jaw bone, and it spread in his face. So I went to visit him, and after salam, I tried yani to talk to him about patience, rewarding from Allah. This is something preordained. We can do nothing. And he was an old man, yani. And alhamdulillah, he was not young to be yani, very desperate or what. He was old and he has all the children and his daughters get married and so on. But he was very, very sad. Look to the point. I said to him, may Allah reward you. And when you are patient, be sure that you will get a high rank in paradise. And the Rasulullah said, anything affecting you in this dunya, you are rewarded for it. But only if you are patient. If you are not what you call blaming Allah. We finished our talk and so, and then at the end he said, I am not happy at all with what Allah had done to me. Then afterwards he said, I am feeling that this is unfair and unjust. And he began to show what is in his heart. I realized that he is very, very weak, and the shaitan is talking in his tongue. What happened at the end of the day? Nothing changed. But he uttered some words. I can't say it is words of kufr, but at least he said many things that I am sure doesn't please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The shaitan came to him while he is weak and said, sah. And this is one of the points that in the conditions of calamity, crisis, disaster, if you are in severe hardship, you are very weak. If you are not a real mu'min, now the shaitan will play his role. If you have weak iman, now your castle is completely open for him. Unfair. Why Allah has done this to you? Why your son got cancer? Why you lost all your money? Why your daughter died? Why she is so and so? What? And because of that, Rasulullah said, إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ عِنْدَ الصَّدْمَةِ الْأُولَى. Patience يعني إيمان comes when it is the first shock of the disaster. يعني are you going to return to Allah or you will open your doors for the shaitan? Are you accepting what had been preordained or no? You will do the same as the Iblis and the shaitan. The Prophet ﷺ saw a woman crying. He was walking with one of the Sahaba. And they told her, Ya Rasulullah, this woman, her son just died now. So, and look, yani, women are very, very fragile in this issue. I said it before. Women are more weak than men. But they have great influence on men. They are very weak, but they can turn you upside down. فإيه اللي حصل؟ شوف, hadith is authentic. The woman was in a shock, yes. This is normal. If I am a mother and my son just died, look what will happen to her. صحيح, she is now in a very, very weak point. So Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم was walking with one of the Sahaba and she was outside, she was crying, screaming. And فرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم went to her. He said to her, يعني, calm down, calm down. She said, go away, go away. You don't know what happened to me. Go away. فرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, he left her. And he went with the Sahabi who was with him. The Sahabi came back to the woman. And he said to her, you didn't know him? He's Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She came running to apologize. Ya Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, I'm very sorry. I didn't realize you. I didn't know you. Of course, for the shock. So Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to her, don't worry, calm down. إنما الصبر عند الصدمة الأولى. Patience is in the first moment of the hardship, of the disaster, of the crisis. Why? Yani now the scholars, when they try to explain this, because at the moment you know this calamity falls on you, you are completely fragile now. What is your response? It differs. Allahu A'lam. Nobody knows. Nobody knows. But when it falls, everyone, according to his iman, he will respond to the disaster. So Rasulullah said to her, "In this, if this happens to any one of us, return to Allah directly." الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إن لله وإن إليه إيش راجعون. And مصيبة here, disaster, the scholars say, the scholars of tafsir of Quran, death. I am taking my father to the hospital, then I got the phone. We are sorry to tell you, your father passed. Huh. Now you got the shock. Or, let us be more يعني realistic, your son. You may love your son more than your father. So what is your response when the shock of the disaster falls on you? Now the Quran and the Sunnah tells us, refer directly to Allah and recite the ayah. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We belong to Allah, we are returning to Him. We belong to Allah, we are returning to Him. خلاص, you are protecting your castle. You are protecting yourself. Because if you don't remind yourself, and now the people around you are also ignorant, and they start screaming, or shouting, or crying, this is now the market for the shaitan. And he will get some words from you. These words may be kufr, they may be shirk. So one of the things here is at the moments of weakness, and this happens when it is you are very happy or you are very sad, try to return directly to Allah when it happens. When you are angry, you lose the control of yourself. When you are angry, I mean يعني a real anger. You are with the brothers and somebody came to you in front of the people and so spit on you and splash, gave you a splash on your face. Huh? What are you going to do? Look to the respond here. I am not saying you have to be cool as an ice, no. But try to keep your mind. This is the shaitan now will come. Oof! What happened to you? Humiliated you? What are you going to do? Box, punch? No, no, not enough. Oh, there is a small knife. طيب خلص. Finish. A man. You spit on me in front of the people? It will never pass. And the shaitan will never leave you, even after a year. The sheikh says here, you will see this guy again. He will remind you. Oh, you forget him? And you will find how the Prophet ﷺ treated the anger. He said, the anger is part of the shaitan. And he said, look to the face of the person when he is angry and the veins. And you lose your mind. So Rasulullah said, if you are angry, don't talk. Sit down. Make wudu. Calm as soon as you can. Don't take any decision if you are angry. Yani, during my life in this country, subhanallah, how many houses were broken in the moments of anger? The mother, the woman is angry or the husband is angry. And look, look, divorce comes in a friction of a second. I want to go to my mother. No, I am not allowing you to go to your mother. Ya akhi, ya my husband, let me go to my mother. No, I am not letting you to go to your mother. Why? You hate my mother. I don't care of your mother. Word by word. I am going to my mother, either you like or not. Ya hit, ya beloved wife, ya bishharifi, sit down. No, I am going, yani I am going. غصب عنك, in Arabic we say. He becomes very angry. You are my wife. Okay, so what? Give me talaq now. The new fashion. Give me my khul' now. You are not a man. I am not a man. Ruhi anti talaq. Ma'a salama. Bye bye. It is divorce. Take your children with you and khalas. It happens. It happens. A lot. A lot of things happen at the time of anger. Now the if we go through this, when they talk about the anger, and the shuyukh talks about the anger, they say that it is instinct. Take care. And sometimes anger is praiseworthy. To be angry for sake of Allah. To be angry that you are not humiliated. Yes, as a Muslim, I will never accept to be humiliated. Okay. But I have to control my mind. I have to control. Rasulullah ﷺ, they said, he doesn't show anger for himself. He always forgives the others. But when it is something for sake of Allah or something regarding the religion, he is very, very angry. He will never sit down till this is correct. And we want to teach ourselves to get angry for sake of Allah, for our deen, for our religion. And for ourselves, yes, we can. We can accept the apology. We can forgive the others. And Rasulullah, when a man came to him, he said to him, Ya Rasulullah, give me an advice. Give me an advice. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to him, don't be angry. He came again. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to him, don't be angry. And the third one, don't be angry. So some people are like this. Their character is to be very quickly angry, and they don't calm quickly. And one of the scholars said regarding the people and regarding this matter, the best man is who his anger is always delayed and he turns to cool very quickly. The worst man is the man who has very low temper. He gets angry very quickly and he doesn't cool quickly. So we, in our religion, we say that anger is sometimes, or in most of the time, you lose the control and you lose your mind. I'm talking about the serious anger. Yeah. And because of that, again, your castle in your heart is open for the shaitan. And Rasulullah ﷺ said, calm down quickly, don't talk, make a wudu, sit down. Even if you are sitting, he said, lie down. Fine, let us stop now for a few minutes and then inshallah we will continue with the shaitan. Jazakumullah khair. صلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه. الرحمن الرحيم. Let us continue our trip with the shaitan, please. Before, يعني we have only, يعني for example, half an hour or less, and then our last session before Ramadan will be the next Monday. We are talking about the shaitan's entry, and we said that there are many things which make it very easy for the shaitan. As one of them, we said al-ghadab. When you are angry, and we said also the ignorance, which we will discuss it, to be ignorant, as well as loving of dunya. Loving of dunya also is a big issue. And very, very few of us can escape from this. We have also lasting hope, and we will go with the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari about how every one of us wished to live and to continue living and extend his life, and this is the lasting hope in the heart which is highly encouraged by the shaitan. We will talk about this. Greed, al-tama', avarice, and the kibr, arrogance. Loving of praising and riya. Also, these two issues are very sensitive. And we will see that one of the Sahaba, he said to the Prophet ﷺ, I do something good and I like people to praise me. Remind me to tell you the hadith, inshallah. Al-ujb, vanity. Also, following the desires. Now, when you have very strong desires and appetite, this can open the gates for the shaitan. Having low opinion of others and despising the Muslims. Al-ihtiqar al-akhareen. You are looking to yourself as يعني, number one, Mr. One, the best. Your nose is always in the sky, as they say. Underestimating the value of sins. This is a big door for the shaitan. Always he will minimize the sin in your eyes. And you will get the hadith ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the great Sahabi. He said, after the Prophet passed, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he went to Iraq, he lived in Iraq, about 30 or 40 years after the Prophet passed. He said to his followers and students, you are doing things which you are completely careless about it. At the time of the Prophet, we used to fear and to think that it is something very major sin. Yani, you are minimizing the sins you are doing. At the time of the Prophet, how the iman in their hearts, they were very sensitive. Also, we have feeling secure about Allah's devising, and despairing of the mercy of Allah also is in the opposite hand. Regarding ignorance, we all know that the ignorant person is very fragile to be broken. The ignorance person is a very soft target for the shaitan. يعني ignorance always comes with كفر, with فسق, with sinning. The person who is ignorant, always away from the truth. And it is very shame for the Muslim to study mathematics and English and so and so. And when you ask him about issues of the religion, the deen, he is nil. Nothing. He can read many books and memorize many things, and he knows issues. I gave him the Quran, try to read two ayah, three ayah, nothing. You can talk a lot about Rooney and David Beckham, and you can get the story of this one and that one. طيب, tell us a little about Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Do you know anything about Abdullah ibn Abbas? Ya akhi, tell me about the wives of the Prophet. Nil. Nothing. This ignorance is something very bad. And nowadays, it becomes prevailing. Ignorance is prevailing. And this is one of the signs of the hour. The minor signs of the hour is that prevailing of ignorance and the raising of knowledge, and the knowledgeable people are very, very few. But you have to fight this. It is your responsibility. Don't talk about the world now and the ummah and the people and the population. It is not your business is yourself. Talk about yourself. You are 20 or 25. Until now, you cannot recite two ayah of the Quran. All of us are, the majority, we are not English people. What is the language which we communicate? English. Why not Arabic? Why not the language of the Quran? Why should I need to translate every word that I'm talking and saying? I was doing khutbah al-jum'ah in Maidaville a month ago, and a man came after the khutbah. He said, okay, Sheikh, I'm happy. Your English is good and you are explaining good. There is another imam who doesn't speak English well. I wish if he speak English and so and so. I had a brother with me. The brother said to him, because the man was complaining a lot because of the weakness of the imam. He said, this imam had been here for 8 years and his English is very poor. Okay, he has a point. The brother who was with me, he said to him, how long have you been praying here? He said, 8 years or 10 years. And what did he say to him? Why you didn't learn Arabic within these 10 years? Instead of blaming the imam. Yes, I think it is a point that when we are talking to, when I am here in England, I have to learn their language. But as a Muslim, you as a Muslim, you have to learn the language of the Quran and the Hadith. Why not? You are very happy in my country, in Egypt. They are very happy when their son speaks English. And the father becomes very proud. Ta'ala ya walid. Ta'ala ya Muhammad. Kallimhum bil-Ingrizi. Yes, how are you? Yes, dad. Yes, mom. Everything is good. And they are very happy. This is some sort of weakness. And it also indicates we don't respect our deen. We don't respect the language. And we are more ignorant. If you lose the language, especially for the Arabs, And some Arabs who were born here, they don't speak Arabic. I don't imagine. The father and the mother are Arabs, and the kids, they don't speak Arabic. For ignorance is one of the way of the shaitan. Here he said it is one of the most significant entries of the shaitan. If not the first, through which all his other entrances begin. Since the ignorant or the foolish are not aware of them, to block the entries of the shaitan. Nor are they aware of rasis,
to nullify them, or at least to avoid them. The devil, Kab, attracted them to his trap, easily overcoming them with the simplest trick. يعني you are ignorant, you have nothing يعني now to defend yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالِ الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُرًا. Shall I tell you, shall I inform you of the greatest losers in their actions? People who efforts in the life of this world are misguided while they suppose or they think that they are doing the good. يعني the ayah here tells us you cannot worship Allah if you are ignorant. You can be deviated and you can turn to bid'ah if you are ignorant. And this is a very important point regarding the bid'ah and the sunnah. And how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it very clear. It is one straight path. We have to learn it. We have to learn it. What is the straight path of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding worshiping Allah in salah, in wudu, in zakah, in Ramadan, in siyam? How? When to fast? When to break the fast? What shall I do in breaking the fast? Ramadan in the corner. What is the best dua when I break my fast? Can I drink before Adhan al-Fajr? Just I waked up very late. Fajr is 3:17. And the calendars now, suhoor ends 20 minutes or 30 minutes before Adhan al-Fajr. I waked up late. It is only 5 minutes for Adhan al-Fajr. Can I drink or not? According to the bid'ah of ending suhoor, I can't. According to the sunnah, I can eat and drink till the adhan starts. Shall I follow the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ or shall I follow these bid'ah calendars? Suhoori end. There is nothing called suhoori end in Islam. Allah says, وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. خلاص. Finished. And we have authentic hadith, and our scholars, they told us, you can eat and drink till Adhan al-Fajr. خلاص, finished. So I don't care of these suhoori end, suhoori thumb, sharfi. Just few weeks ago, not few weeks, I'm in Wembley Mosque. And we find the Salat al-Isha, it was full. And people coming from everywhere, some of them with this turban, green turban. Old. Yabni, Shada. What is this? 15th of Sha'ban. So what, 15th of Sha'ban? Oh, the day of forgiveness. Yabni, if you pray with us, يا شيخ تعال تعال ايه يا ابني pray with us at the night of Sha'ban, all your sins will be forgiven, your parents will be in the highest rank of paradise. ايه ده؟ And the mid of Sha'ban, they think that the mid of Sha'ban is as Laylatul Qadr. They are coming to celebrate, and I found one of them taking the mic and starting to talk all fabricated a hadith. Ignorance. And the brothers, they told me, they come every year, and before Fajr they go out and they return back to sleep at home. So they don't pray the Faridah, and they do this bid'ah, and they think that this is the deen. Ya akhi ta'allim, ya akhi aqra, read and learn. Allah ask, go to the books. But because you are ignorant, you are blindly folded, and you are, somebody can take you with your blind eyes. Khalas, shaitan is widely spreading. It is not deen. The deen is finished after Prophet Muhammad. Nobody can add anything. The other thing in the day of Ashura, the 10th of Muharram. Either the whole mosques and people and sitting and the main issue, Ya Hussein, Ya Ali, Ya Hussein, Ya Ali. يا ابني بتعمل ايه؟ What are you doing? You are celebrating the death of Al-Hussein. We love Ahl al-Bayt. I took to one of them in Nizdi. Another fight in the mosque of Nizdi near my house. And he said to me, oh, you Wahhabi, go out, go out. Allah al-Azim. I said to him, you are a real ignorant. A real ignorant. We never celebrate the death of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We never celebrate the death of Abu Bakr or Umar or Uthman or even Ali ibn Abi Talib, the father. And all of those are greater than Al-Hassan al-Hussein. Al-Hassan al-Hussein are greater, great Muslimin. But we never celebrate the death of anyone. So how do you come to say we have to celebrate the death of Al-Hussein? And then they do the shirk. يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين وأن المساجد لله فلا تدعو مع الله أحد. It is very clear in the Holy Quran. The verse is very clear. These mosques are only for Allah. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. Because of ignorance, complete ignorance, this is another deen now. The deen of the Shia, Rawafid. Complete deviate sect. Al-Rawafid have their own deen. They don't care of the Quran or the Sunnah or Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They do it by their own mind. So some Sunni Muslims are following them. Ignorance is the door of shaitan. طيب, for you here, sitting here, don't be one of the ignorant. Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib said, be either a scholar or a learner, a student, and don't ever be the third one. The third one is the ignorant blind man who anybody can take him. Don't be ignorant, yabni. You are very happy with yourself, ya salam. I have a car, I have a bank account, I am sharifi, I am so, I have my own degree, and you are ignorant. You are ignorant. And because of that, the great blessing of the circles of knowledge. Rasulullah said, these circles of knowledge, your name is mentioned now in the heaven. And the angels attending with us. And Allah is very happy. Imagine, this is halaq al-dhikr, the circles of knowledge. When we are reminding ourselves, we are learning Allah, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. We are learning what our teacher Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. This is the best thing you can do in your life. So to end this point, and take care that the shaitan do his best to prevent you from seeking knowledge. All the excuses will be given. I have no time. I have no money. I am working. But when it is any worldly issues, you are the first. When it comes to seeking knowledge for sake of Allah, to purify your heart and yourself, hundreds of excuses will happen, will appear. And here he said, one entry of the shaitan to the ignorant person is to prevent him from seeking knowledge. As he would say to him or to her, do you want to be a student in this age? Especially if you are passing the age or you have some younger students with you. There is a lot about the second point. We said the anger. And whenever the person becomes angry, the shaitan comes, infiltrates, and try to boost the anger more and more. And look to the people when they are really angry. طيب, now through the Islamic instructions, calm down quickly when you are angry. Don't make a decision. Go to wudu, sit down, calm down. whenever anger cools off, the shaitan stirs it up again by saying that the person with whom you are angry is having fun on you, mocking on you, you have to avenge and so and so. Many hadiths here about the anger. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, who is the strong man, the real strong man? He's not the man who can do the wrestle. You call it a wrestle, this one. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, a real strong man is not the one who wrestles well, but a strong man is the one who controls himself when he is in fit of rage. يبقى ليس الشديد بالسرعة ولكن الشديد الذي يملك نفسه عند الغضب. Look to yourself when you are angry and tell us the level of your how can you control. And we mentioned the hadith, don't be angry, don't become angry and furious. Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said, number one, seek refuge in Allah. قل أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Again, the shaitan is very weak. The shaitan is very weak. Allah said in the Holy Quran, إن كيد الشيطان كان ضعيفا. But what about the kaid of the woman? When it is described in the shaitan, when you recite Surah Yusuf, how the woman plotted, conspired to put Yusuf alayhi salam and to push him to the zina with the woman number one, the prime minister wife. Allah said, إن كيدكن عظيم. Great. The woman mockery or conspiracy can be greater than the shaitan. So Allah described the shaitan as a weak when you remember Allah, weak when you know how to close his entrance, weak when you say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, weak when you recite the Quran diary, Surah Al-Kursi and قل أعوذ برب الفلق قل أعوذ برب الناس. So Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم said استعد بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Then everyone should remember the great reward of suppressing his anger and fury. Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم also asked us to be silent, to sit down and to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Quran said والكاظمين الغيظ. الكاظمين الغيظ, those who control their rage and pardon others people, Allah loves them. الذين ينفقون في السراء والضراء, in Surah Al Imran. والكاظمين الغيظ, يعني suppress your anger. Now one of the main entrance of the shaitan, which is very difficult for all of us, is loving dunya. Loving dunya. Dunya is very beautified, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. And nowadays it is very, very beautified in this era. You can sit down and talk to your brother in Somalia, and you can see a brother whom you are talking to in China. You have an iPhone and a laptop and sharifi with internet. Very comfortable life, very luxurious. And you have just a remote control and a sofa and the car air condition. لا إله إلا الله. This is the ayah. حتى إذا أخذت الأرض زخرفها ينت. It is glittering. Glittering. And very easy. Many of you can easily get money, alhamdulillah, and you can يعني live luxurious life. And you love dunya more and more. طيب, the gate is open for the shaitan. Loving dunya, I want to settle, I want to more, means that your relation with akhirah will decrease and decline. You don't want to leave this dunya. You don't want to leave the happiness here. Alhamdulillah, you are very happy. طيب أقول. Okay. And it is very attractive. And alhamdulillah, many things. Allah gives us a lot. The woman, you have the woman. Kids, you have kids. Car, you have a car. House, you have a house. Hey, what do you want more? Dunya, loving dunya contradict with loving akhirah. يعني if you go beyond the limit, I mean, how to make the balance? When we talk about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the this dunya is nothing in their eye, in his eye, as well as the Sahaba. And he taught us, he taught the Ummah, this dunya, all of this life is worthless in the sight of Allah. فَدَوْنْتْ make it your main concern. Don't be as a kafir. Don't be as a kafir. Because the main concern for the kafir is his dunya. He wants to enjoy his time from A to Z. And because of that, whenever anything happens to him, become a completely lost, desperate, completely depression. He wants to live, and she wants to live with full enjoyment and entertainment and happiness. This is not life. This is not life. The nature of life is not like this. And look now to the ayat of the hadith. The shaitan adorns this worldly life and makes it seem very good in the hearts of many people, in the hearts of the Muslimin. We are not talking about the kuffar now. So when he beautified this dunya in your heart, he is declining loving akhirah in your heart. He is attracting you to be more attached to dunya. طيب, go to Umrah and Hajj. No. Come for Salat al-Jum'ah. No. I go directly at the last 5 minutes. I have my work. Come to Circus for Knowledge. No. I will not leave my business for this. Your main issue. My holiday. As the kuffar. August. Going this year to Switzerland. Tomorrow I'm going the next year to France. And so you are planning always for dunya. Again, it is not completely haram because we are human beings, but it goes beyond the limit, it becomes haram, and it will distract you completely, and it will weaken your iman. Look quickly, the Sheikh said 5 minutes, time. Let us go. قَالَ رَبِّ بِمَا أَغْوَيْتَنِي. Look to the saying of the shaitan in the Quran. He said, لَأُزَيِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِي. يبقى الشيطان is disclosing his plan, how he will attack your heart. So the ayah here says, it is in Surah Al-Hijr, the verse number 39. In Surah Al-Hijr, the shaitan said, my Lord, Rabbi, because you misled me, I will make things on the earth seem very good, attractive to them, and I will mislead them all. طيب, it is very clear now. It may be something simple, but he makes it in your eyes. You want it. You struggle, you fight for it. Anything in dunya. You may spend all your time. You do a lot of effort. Dunya, money, luxurious, life, whatever. And وَلَقَدْ صَدَّقَ عَلَيْهِمْ إِبْلِيسُ ظَنَّا فَاتَّبَعُوهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Iblis was correct in his assessment of them, and they followed him, except for a group of the believers. Only the believers who can stop this man. Allah said, اعلموا انما الحياة الدنيا لعب ولهو وزينة. This dunya is nothing but this worldly, merely a game and a diversion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, سابقوا الى مغفرة من ربكم وجنة عرضها السماوات والأرض. If you want to compete, if you want to do an effort, do it for paradise. Do it for paradise. Build your palace in paradise. Work hard for Allah, for after death. But working for dunya, you are the same as the kafir, the Sikh, the Bodhi, the Christian. All of people are fighting for dunya. We are fighting for akhir. And we are not deprived of dunya. We don't say to you, sit down or stay in the mosque day and night. No. But main concern is akhir. My main concern is the next. My main concern is my palace in paradise. I don't care about here. One day you eat meat, the other day you eat chapati, third day you eat a piece of bread. Alhamdulillah. No problem. You have X5 car, you have a Renault, you have a Fiat, you are coming by bus. Alhamdulillah. So what? So what? If you are Bill Gates, you have 70 billion, or you are a simple يعني farmer or a guardian, you will eat the same thing and you will sleep and that's it, and the time is going. طيب, the issue of loving the dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلْهَاكُمُ التَّكَاثُرُ حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرُ. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the ayah says, abundance diverts you. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the son of Adam claims, my wealth, my money, my wealth and my money. And he added, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O son of Adam, is there anything that you claim as your belongings, as that which you consumed, utilized, or wore until it was worn out, or you gave away in charity, and this is what is sent forward. Sayyida Aisha, when she kept the sheep, and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what have you done? She said, I gave the sheep to the people, but I kept the shoulder. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to her and corrected her, no, everything was kept, but the shoulder is the thing which we lost. Yeah, the thing you are keeping and utilizing, you are losing it. But the thing you are keeping for sake of Allah and the charity you are paying for sake of Allah is what is kept for you. So I think we have to finish now. The issue of hubb al-dunya is great and I think it needs more. Inshallah, if we are alive next week, we will try to go with the other entrance of the shaitan and we will try to summarize how to deal with these entrances and to protect ourselves. جزاكم الله خير وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.
Apologies, brother, there will be no Q&A because Salah starts.